A very good morning to all, and let us start our next speaker. And I'm really delighted to introduce my colleague, Professor Sachin Kumar Srivastav from IIT Roorkee, Department of Physics. Professor Sachin has received his PhD in physics from IIT Delhi in the year 2012. During 2012 to 15, he worked in Ben Gurion University, Israel, where he availed the prestigious PVC postdoctoral fellowship from the government of Israel. During 15-16, he worked as a research fellow in the prestigious NTU, HUJ, BGU CREATE program at Nanyang Technological University. He also held a position in charge of R&D and technical operation in Asia in Photonics company. In 2016, he earned the Inspire Faculty Fellowship to join CSIR, Central Scientific Instrument Organization, Chandigarh, India, where he was a scientist during 2017-18. Currently, he is an assistant professor in our Department of Physics, IIT Roorkee. Dr. Srivastav has co-authored 21 research papers in journals of international repute and book titled Fiber Optic Sensors Based on Plasmonics. He is editor of the Journal of Sensors, a regular member of Optical Society of America, and life member of Optical Society of India. He is also a member of OSA Nano Photonics and OSA Optical Biosensors Executive Committee. So with this brief introduction, I would like to invite Professor Sachin to talk about surface enhanced resonance spectroscopy. Professor Sachin, please.
Okay, thank you, Professor Ghosh, for your kind introduction. I would like to thank Professor Ravindra Pandey for inviting me to present my work here and to speak in this webinar. Hello everyone, I am Sachin Kumar Srivastava from the Department of Physics in IIT Roorkee. Today, I'm going to talk about surface enhanced Raman spectroscopy. In particular, my focus will be on surfaces because I think one of the speakers has already, day before yesterday, one of the speakers has already talked about Raman spectroscopy. We are going to see more into it and we want to see what kind of surfaces are used to enhance the Raman spectra. Okay, that will be my focus. In my group, we use various kind of techniques, which are again the surfaces, to enhance spectroscopic signals. So when I'm talking about these surfaces, it doesn't only explicitly enhance the Raman spectra, but also it can be used to enhance, say, for example, fluorescence signals, say, for example, absorbance, or any other phenomena you want to see. People are also using these kind of surfaces to enhance solar cells. You can use these kind of surfaces for enhancing the signals which are taking place at the surfaces. And so if you want to study, say, for example, dynamics of some biological reaction or chemical reaction on a surface, it is a very good surface and to see and study those phenomena. In this picture, which is again taken from my lab experiments, you can see that there is a laser coming from here. Actually, there is a polarizer also. And the polarizer plays a very crucial role in this kind of studies. And then you have a prism. And on top, you can see there are certain excitations here like this. This is a very beautiful picture, so I thought I will put it here. So there is a drop here of some analyte, and it is exciting certain optical signals. You can see some yellowish signal here. One more thing is that light, you see that there is a water drop. So light is coming like this and then getting total internally reflected, and then again back and forth reflections. And this kind of things is captured from a microscope objective, put it on the top. So this is a very beautiful experiment, but if time permits, of course, we will go to see how these things are working. But let me start with what is Raman spectroscopy. So in Raman spectroscopy, we see that if you have a molecule, a small molecule, and you shine it with a laser, so what will happen that it will scatter light. Most of the light which it is scatters is basically Rayleigh scatter. Oops. And what? Okay, now it's working. Sometimes the pen is not working. I'm sorry. I need to replace the battery. So you can see that most of the light is Rayleigh scattered, and a very small fraction, a very small fraction of this scattered light is Raman scattered. So what is the difference here? What is the difference here? See, when you shine this molecule with, let us say, this green light, let us say this a particular frequency h nu, then it is making this molecule to be kind of induced dipole. Then this induced dipole scatters back the light of the same frequency. That is Rayleigh scattering, but very small fraction, very, very small fraction of the scattered light doesn't have the same frequency as the excitation light. You can see there is a small gap here, or a small gap here. So there is a small change in the frequency. A very small portion of this scattered light will have frequencies which are either larger than the excitation frequency or the smaller that. So if you have, say, this molecule and you are incident with green light here, it will be either red shifted or green shifted, blue shifted. Red shifted or blue shifted. Red shifted means it has smaller frequencies. Blue shifted means it has larger frequency than the incident light. And that is the very basic of Raman spectroscopy, because this small shift which we are talking about, this small shift is a fingerprint of the molecular bonds and the crystalline structure of the molecule. So if you want to study a molecule and you want to study the chemical structure of this molecular bonds and what kind of vibrations are taking place, this is a fingerprint, this is small shift. But the problem is that out of 10 million photons, only one photon gets scattered which has changed frequencies. So only one photon out of 10 million photon is Raman scattered. That is the problem. So you may think how difficult it was, how challenging it was at the times in 1928 when Raman discovered this beautiful phenomenon. There were no lasers. He used simply sunlight, and it took him few days to record the spectra to confirm this thing. Nowadays you can use lasers and you can confirm the molecular structure or crystalline structure within few minutes or few seconds. So that is the advantage with the advent of lasers. Now you want to further enhance this, and that enhancement now is coming from the surface. So what kind of surfaces this is? These are rough or corrugated metallic surfaces. We call them plasmonic surfaces, plasmonic structures. These are plasmonic structures which we are going to use to enhance the Raman signal. So there are various kind of plasmonic structures. People use something called surface plasmon resonance, where it is the same kind of structure which I was showing. You have a prism here, and with this prism you have on the top of the prism you have a slide which is coated with metal, and then you extract surface plasmons. You can have localized surface plasmon or surf films. Again, this is called surf films because it is enhancing the Raman signal. You can have nanocells also. Nanocells is like a cell on top of something, and the width of this cell is only few nanometers. You can have semi-continuous films means like they are not continuous films. They are having some gap between these structures, and these are of course made of metal. Okay, so these are kind of films which people use to enhance the Raman signal. Before I proceed further, I would like to make a bit of advertisement, and I would like to show you what kind of studies we are doing in our research group. And if you find it interesting and want to work with me on some, collaborate with me on some of the research problems, you are most welcome. So let us see what we are working on. So I have a lab on applied nanophotonics, where we are working on the nanostructures, and primarily these studies are to study the photonic processes, where we are working, where in one of the domains is fiber optic plasmonic sensors, where we are working on SPR and LSPR based sensors. Okay, that is the work primarily which I was working in during my PhD. And you can see that in this kind of structures, when you have optical fiber, you take out a small portion of the cladding, and then you do coating of SPR or LSPR structures, and that is used for sensing. So you can see that there is a shift in resonance. I will discuss it more. So if you are interested, you can see more on this in my book, which I published with my supervisor. Other domain of work is extraordinary transmission, where we use nanoslit arrays of metal. And this nanoslit arrays, when I say extraordinary transmission, that means the gap between these slits is much smaller than the wavelength. So these are actually sub wavelength structures, and when you have sub wavelength structures, you can have extraordinary transmission. Again, we are working on only sensing applications, so we design and fabricate this kind of structures. Then we work on prism based SPR sensors, where you have different configurations of this, and again we work for detection of various analytes. Also, you can use it for studying various dynamical processes happening on the surface. So light travels like this, and then you have certain interactions taking place, and that modulates the signal which is coming out. And by measuring the modulations in the signal of this light which was incident, you can say what kind of interactions are taking place. So if you are doing this in real time, you can measure the dynamics, you can study the dynamics of the chemical reaction or biological processes, whatever happening on the surface. The same can be done using imaging, rather using a detector. You can use a camera to detect this, and if there is a resonance, you see that there is a dark line here, and this dark line moves up and down depending on the kind of interactions which are happening here. So this is the very basic of the device which we were selling in this photonics company. We are further improving the performance of these sensors and these devices by using different or structured light. If you can see here that we use some specialized beam that we call designer beams. And in the designer beams, you can see that the SPR resonance becomes very thin, so you can improve the something called figure of merit. Okay, that is one advantage. The main catch of this talk is plasmon enhanced spectroscopy is where we are using a film which is called nanosculpture thin film. These are basically films like fingers and finger like structures you can see, and these finger like structures are of made of metal, and you can enhance the Raman signal as well as fluorescence signal as well as absorption, whatever you want, based on certain design parameters. We will discuss that. So this is one of the domain which we are working. Other domain is now coupling. You know, these are, when I'm saying in the previous slide we showed that there are films, now here there are structures which are not continuous. The continuous films, here they excite something called, they support something called propagating or extended surface plasmons. The structures which I've discussed here, they support something called localized surface plasmons. And now we want to see the coupling between these two, extended and localized surface plasmons. And the idea is that if you create, you can see here in this field diagram that there is a metallic film, on top of it a very small gap, and then you have a metallic nanosphere. Of course, this nanosphere is very small. You can see that it is around 60 nanometers or so, and you can see that the field in the this close region is very high, very high, log of 10 to power 6. So log of 10 to 3.6, that is very high. So what it means, this is called hotspot. So if you place a molecule in this region, you can have enhanced signal. So that is our purpose. So we want to use this for ultra high field enhancements. Of course, it needs certain optimizations. That's what we are working on. It's not like you place it randomly and you get enhanced signal. And the signal which we could enhance is about 10 to power 10 times. Okay. And the last field, which of course is with a collaboration with someone, it is Dr. Samir Kumar Mandal from the Institute CSIR CSIO, where he is preparing this very beautiful nano antenna on the tips of optical fiber, and then these can produce structured beams. And this nano antenna, you can see that light can be confined on the tip of this fiber, and it becomes so intense field that if you place the nanoparticle here, it will have enhanced optical properties. And that is the goal here, that it can be used to enhance the Raman signal also and fluorescence signal also. And not only that, people has used such kind of tips to enhance the Raman signal, and that is called TERS, tip enhanced Raman spectroscopy. So these are certain fields which we have been talking, and we use these kind of structures, permutations and combinations of these, to study various spectroscopy phenomena, to enhance these phenomena, and then to use them for various applications, primarily in the field of sensing. Okay, so here is the outline of my talk. Today we are going to discuss what is Raman spectroscopy. We discussed basically what is Raman spectroscopy, but what are the applications, that's important. And then we are, as I told in the beginning of this lecture, that we are going to focus our attention, our domain, to the field of the surfaces which are going to enhance the Raman signals. So we will limit to those surfaces. So that's why I have put it like this, that we are going to study what are plasmons, we will study extended plasmons, localized plasmons, and then we'll see how localized plasmons are enhancing the Raman, and then we will see the coupling. So actually it is the field enhancements which are the crucial part, and these field enhancements lead to enhancement of the Raman signal. That's why I thought that I will put it here both, and then we will see that what happens to the coupling. Actually, coupling is something which people have been trying for few years, I mean couple of decades, and when this talk progresses, I will discuss more about the challenges which people had faced, various researchers have faced, and how these challenges can be overcome to get enhanced signal. Okay, so in Raman spectroscopy, as I talked previously, that when you it is like this: you have a molecule, and you have a molecule here, and you are signing it with an electromagnetic wave. Let us say that the electric field is like this. So it means that you are placing this molecule in an electric field which has frequency of omega, that is the frequency of light, and it is around 10 to power 14 per second, radians per second, you can say. So this is the molecule which is exposed to a field which is varying with time. So what it means, this molecule, this is the basis of whole spectroscopy. I'm not going to into the detail of this, but this molecule can have a dipole moment, permanent dipole moment, then it will behave differently, that leads to rise of fluorescence and IR and microwave, all these spectroscopies. But let us say that this molecule is not polarized, it doesn't have a dipole moment. So what will it do? This molecule, when the it will be polarized, okay? So if the field is like this, the electrons will move in the other direction. Actually, it will be like in the other direction. So it will be a dipole. It will make a dipole in this direction. And this dipole, see, this dipole is subjected to a time-varying field. So basically, this dipole will start to oscillate around the same frequency as the frequency of the light. This oscillating dipole will now scatter light. That is the scattering. That is what is happening in all the processes which are taking place, even the reflection, refraction, transmission, whatever you study, the scattering, why the sky is blue and all these things, Rayleigh scattering, Raman scattering, all these processes are because of the scattered light due to this. You can pre-assume that it is a dipole. It might not be a dipole also. So this molecule became an induced dipole. And this induced dipole is now scattering light. The expression for the polarizability, because it gets polarized, you have the expression for polarizability, and polarizability is this alpha. So polarization is proportional to the electric field. The larger is the electric field, the larger it can, you know, make the dipole to be larger, and the dipole moment becomes large. So if the polarization is proportional to the electric field, the larger the electric field, the larger is the polarization. So in actual molecule, this becomes a tensor. Okay, in an actual molecule, it can be a tensor, because we can see the polarizabilities in all the directions. Okay, that is the thing. So what is the use here? You see, I am taking a very simple molecule, which is carbon dioxide, and you can see that it is COO. And this molecule have kind of various kind of vibrations which are here, V1, V3, V2. You see that this molecule is symmetric here, the modes. Here they are symmetric like this, either it is shifted to this or it is shifted to this. These are kind of other modes, and these are bending modes. Now these are bent. So these are different kinds of modes which can be there. You see, when you have this kind of dislocations here, what is happening is that you have a permanent dipole moment here. You have a permanent dipole in these two cases. And when you have permanent dipole, these molecules are IR active. But when you have you don't have permanent dipole, you induce a dipole, then it becomes Raman active. So if you want to see the vibrational modes of carbon dioxide in IR spectra, you see the bending mode, you see the asymmetric stretching mode, but you don't see the Raman mode. So it means, and they are almost having the same kind of frequencies. You see, they are having almost same kind of frequencies because these are the same kind of bonds. But the molecules which don't have permanent dipole moment, they show Raman spectra, they don't show IR spectra. So if you have a complex matrix, this Raman spectra are complement to the IR spectra. Raman spectra are complementary to the IR spectra. So if you want to study the complete system, it is not just the Raman spectra, but IR spectra both, that will make the complete understanding of the system. Okay. What is the use? One of the uses is, I am going to show you a couple of uses which are done in the industry. So this is to stop fraud. How are you going to stop fraud? How are you going to stop fraud? So this is, let us say, pearl, and you want to purchase this pearl garland for someone dear to you. You can see that these are the Raman spectra for pearl, actual pearl. And if you have fox pearl, you have the Raman spectra like this. So by seeing the differences between these, you can say which one is the actual one and which one is the fox, Raman spectra, the fox pearl. This is another study which is done using Raman microscopy. And what people do is that you can map a drug tablet with Raman microscopy. And you can see that they are almost the same, but it has microcrystalline cellulose, which makes a difference between these. And you can have fast color images also, so that will also tell you which one is good one and which one is the not the correct or the drug which you want. So this way, if you study the Raman spectra of the drug sample, you can say that this is the drug you want or not, the composition of the drug. Okay. Now let us understand what are the plasmons. So this is Raman spectra. We talked about Raman spectra and the applications, couple of applications, that how it can be helpful for detecting things in the day-to-day life. There are more examples, for example, juices, food, meat, and environment. I will show you that we did some sensing of bacteria or something using Raman spectroscopy. But we want to enhance these signals. And to enhance these signals, I already told you that we use surfaces which are rough metallic surfaces, and these we call plasmonic surfaces. Now I'm going to tell you what is the plasmon. If you don't understand anything in the middle of the talk, you can ask. There is no problem. It has to be, let it be interactive. Otherwise, like, you can write the answer questions in the comment box, and we'll take them after the talk. So plasmons, the definition is that they are quanta of longitudinal oscillations of free electrons in the metal. And why we call it plasma? Because it is plasmon, because it is synonymous to plasma, like one component plasma, because there are large number of electrons are involved. So when you take, say, gold or silver, and this has large number of free electrons, let us say that there are no bound electrons, they are free. I am considering only the free electrons. And if they are making collective oscillations like this, then this is the quanta of this is called plasmon. So you can assume that the room in which you are sitting, you can assume that this room is full of electrons, and there is a positive background also. Positive background, in this positive background, the electrons are free to move. The electrons are like this, one line. Suppose I am taking one line of this, okay? Like you are sitting, like you are in the line of to get a cinema ticket. and suddenly someone pushes from behind. What will happen? Everyone will lean to the counter, and then suddenly the person who is at the counter will say, "Oh no." Then everyone will go back, leaning like this. Okay? Similarly, somehow you have this electrons in the room, and somehow you push, you give a push to the electron cloud, electrons in the sea. What will happen? When you push it, there are electrons all over. Some electrons will come close to the other electrons, and then they will go away from the positive background. You see, so what will happen is that the electrons which is reaching close to the other electron, it will repel, and at the same time the positive background is pulling it. Okay, so this guy is kind of restoring force. It is restoring to the position of the electron which you displaced. So it will come back, but it will not come back to the original position. It will go little further and then further and then further. So this kind of motion is starting. Okay, this kind of motion is starting. This is longitudinal motion. You can think of it again like this, the image which I have shown here. You can see that you can expect the metal as a sea of free electrons with a solid positive background. Suppose like this water, you have electrons, and then you drop a pebble, a small stone. What will happen? You will have waves traveling on the surface like this. What is inside happening inside? What is happening inside? See, inside when it starts, it will lead to generation of cylindrical waves which are traveling like this, going away. Compression, rarefaction, compression, rarefaction, something like this is happening inside. Inside, I'm not talking about the top for now. These are longitudinal oscillations. These are longitudinal oscillations, and these kind of oscillations are plasmons. Longitudinal oscillations. What is happening on the surface? This is happening in the bulk. What is happening in the surface? On the surface, you see these kind of oscillations. These oscillations on the surface are having both the longitudinal component and the transverse component. If you place a small piece of paper, let us say on the surface, what will happen? You will see that it is going up and down, and slowly it is moving also outside. So up and down motion says that there is this kind of wave which is transverse in nature, and this kind of motion will tell that this is partly longitudinal also. Now think about it. Light is a transverse wave. So suppose you have a big piece of metal and you want to excite plasmons. You hit it with light. Suppose this surface is metal. You hit it with light. Can you excite plasmons? The answer is no, because the bulk plasmons are longitudinal oscillations. Light is a transverse wave, so you can excite plasmons using light on the surface. That is not so easy. Someone says, okay, for example, I have wearing this ring of silver. I shine it with light. Can I excite plasmons? Simply, the answer is no. We'll see why. So that's why we talk about surface plasmons, because when you are studying it with light, on the surface only you can excite plasmons. So surface plasmons are coherent oscillations of the free electrons at the interface of two media with opposite dielectric constants. One should be metal and another should be dielectric. So suppose you have a metal dielectric interface. At this interface, you can excite this wave which is traveling along the interface, and when it travels along the interface, slowly it dies out. Why it dies out and what are the benefits, I will tell. So it propagates along the interface. When it is excited, the field is maximum at the top, at the interface, and it decays exponentially in both the metal and the dielectric. So metal is more lossy, so you can see that it dies out very quickly, while in the dielectric it goes slowly. And this is transverse magnetic polarized. So I will we are running out of time, so I will move a bit quickly. Okay, so here I said transverse magnetic polarized. So let us say what is transverse electric and transverse magnetic polarized. You know, transverse electric means P transverse magnetic is P polarization and transverse electric means S polarization. P polarization means electric field is parallel to the plane of incidence here, and S is like electric field is perpendicular to the plane of incidence. So transverse electric means electric field is transverse. Transverse magnetic means magnetic field is transverse. Transverse means 90 degrees perpendicular to what? To the plane of incidence. The plane where you see the change in the refractive index. You see the plane of incidence is the plane where you seeing the change in the refractive index. So if let us say it is Z and X and you have Y, Y is perpendicular direction. So if the electric field is perpendicular to this Y, this is transverse electric. If the magnetic field is perpendicular to Y, not in the direction of Y. If the electric field is in the direction of Y, you have transverse electric. If you have magnetic field in the direction of Y, you have transverse magnetic. So when you have magnetic field in the Y direction, where will be the electric field? Electric field will be in the plane. In the plane. So when you are considering the transverse magnetic, that means the electric field in the plane. Transverse electric means magnetic field in the plane, but electric field is perpendicular direction. Okay, so remember that. So when you solve for the equations for transverse electric and transverse magnetic, in this case particular EZ EX EY, so you have EY is the transverse electric and HY tells you the transverse magnetic. So if HY is there, EX and EZ fall in this plane, in this plane, and here similarly HX and HZ fall in this plane. So you can write the equations of the wave equation in terms of the transverse field. So this is for transverse electric and this is for transverse magnetic. So if you want to see the exponentially decaying solution, these are the exponentially decaying solutions for this thing, because we want to consider only the dying solutions. So if you want to see the decaying wave solutions, you can see that you can solve for the boundary conditions here, and you have this coefficients A, B, C, and D. So if you solve for the boundary conditions which are here, you get this relation, and if you solve for this, the surface plasmon wave vector is given by this relation, where epsilon is the dielectric function of the dielectric. So suppose you had a dielectric here, epsilon S, and you have metal here, epsilon M, and light is incident on it. So the wave vector of surface plasmon wave which will get generated here will be given by this relation. Omega by C is the omega is frequency of light which is incident, and C is the speed of light. So this is the relation of the surface plasmon wave vector. So if you plot this, before we plot, let us try to understand why we are not getting why do we need a metal and a dielectric surface, why not dielectric and dielectric. So you can see that when you have dielectric and metal surface, you can lie the electric and magnetic fields like this in both the media, and you apply the boundary conditions, you arrive to this condition. So you can see that KZ1 and KZ2 are the wave vectors in the Z direction, in this Z direction and in this Z direction. So they are all positive. So what has to be negative? The negative, because they are all having opposite sign. So this condition will be satisfied if these are of opposite signs. Okay, so that's why one material has to have positive epsilon 1 and second one has to have negative epsilon, and that's why the one of the materials should have to be metal. That is the condition. Okay, if you have transverse electric modes and you apply the boundary conditions, you get this coefficient equal to 0, because K0 is not 0, this is not 0, so only this becomes 0. So that's why you don't have any solutions for the wave equation when you have transverse electric modes. So that's why only transverse magnetic modes will give rise to surface plasmons. The physics you can understand from here, that if you have electric field in this plane, it will have the boundary conditions, you will have the polarization. So when the electric field is in the plane, it will create polarization charges, and these polarization charges are the ones which will respond to the light, and that's why you are getting surface plasmons. when the electric field is perpendicular, let us say that this is, these two fingers represent metal and two fingers represent dielectric, and electric field is like this. So it is either falling in this range or this range. It is not creating any polarization charges. If the electric field is like this, then there will be polarizations here. So it will have a polarization difference here, the polarization charges P1z and P2z, and this is responsible for the. So that is the physics. The mathematics I showed you, why TE mode cannot excite surface plasmons and TM can. Now the physics is that this creates polarization charges. When you have S polarized light, there is no polarization charges here. You see here, this is P polarization. You have polarizations. When you have S polarization, there is no P term here in this. And that's why no polarization charges can be generated and no surface modes can be excited. But if you plot, let us say that you have metal dielectric interface here. You have dielectric, say air. This is metal. On top of it, you have air, and you shine it with light, like this. Can you excite surface plasmons? No. Why? If you see the dispersion curve, this is called omega versus k curve. Omega versus k curve. This is called dispersion relation. So light which is falling, light which is traveling through a medium, this wave vector k is given by this relation. That is called the light line. But the surface plasmon wave vector is given by this black curve. If you plot this, we have already solved for this. Okay, so now you see that if you are if you are incident with a wavelength of lambda, or you can say the frequency omega light falling on this surface, the wave vector of surface plasmon is here is larger than the wave vector of light. So there is a kind of momentum mismatch. There is kind of momentum mismatch. So that's called phase mismatch. You cannot excite surface plasmon. So what you are going to do? We make this film very thin, very thin. This dielectric, and bring a prism on top. And this prism is now. So what will happen with the prism? That it will increase the wave vector, and you can change the angle. So at certain value angle, you know, this will intersect here. So this is called the resonance condition, and you will get. So light, you are incident with light like this, and you are measuring the reflected power, and you are changing the angle. So at certain angle, this resonance will occur here, and then you will have a dip in the reflected light. This is called surface plasmon resonance condition. If you change the material reflective index here, let us say it was n1, now you change the dielectric metal reflective index to n2. N1 greater than N2, let us say, again, it makes a green curve now. So again, you need to increase the theta. You increase the theta such that this wave vector matches again. So you have to move from A to B so that theta 1 moves to theta 2. That's how you change the refractive index. You change the refractive index, and it led to change in the resonance condition. By measuring this change, you can say how much change in the refractive index occurred. The same thing you can do with wavelength also. You don't want to change the angle. You are fixing the wavelength. So you are using white light. So it will be having the wavelength. It is different wavelength now. So now you are measuring lambda and lambda 2. That is called spectral interrogation. Previously, it was called angular interrogation. This is the very basic principle of surface plasmon resonance. This is the very basic principle. So see what is happening here. When there is some interaction taking place at the surface of the metal in the dielectric region, this interaction is leading to change in the refractive index. This change in the refractive index will change the resonance parameter. And this change in resonance parameter will tell you how much change in the refractive index or how much interaction taking place there. So you can correlate the interaction which is taking place with the change in the resonance parameter. This is the very basic principle of surface plasmon resonance. So those of you who are using surface plasmon resonance technique, this is the very basic principle. Okay. There are other methods of excitation. See, this is very difficult to maintain this small gap. This gap is say around 1 micron. 1 micron or so, or less. So it is very difficult to maintain 1 micron gap. So what people did is that they coated directly on the base of the prism, and since that there is an evanescent field which is penetrating through, so you can still excite surface plasmons at this interface. That is the beauty. You can use it grating, and the extra phase, extra momentum which was missing for surface plasmons is given by the diffraction orders. So this is the momentum of the incident wave. This extra is given by the diffracted orders, and for the diffracted order which is matched in the reflected light, you will see that light is getting missing. You can remove the prism by the core of optical fiber, and then you can do this metal coating in place of the cladding, and then you can use it for the same purpose. So these are other methods of SPR realization. There are two important properties of surface plasmons. One is propagation length. When this wave gets excited, I told in the beginning that when it travels along the interface, it dies out after a certain time. Why it dies out? Because of this term. Here, this term. You have imaginary value of the wave vector in the x direction. So when you have imaginary value also, after a certain time, this dies out. And because of this, there is a propagation length along the interface. So you can see that I have calculated it for gold layer and silver layer, and you can see that only few microns. So you can make a device only few microns and it is still working. So you can have miniature devices, you can make devices on chip to study interactions of the surfaces at the surfaces. Second thing is penetration depth. How much is the field penetrating? You see, the field is penetrating both the media in metal and dielectric. This is metal, this is dielectric. So you can see that this is only few nanometers to up to few hundred nanometers. We are not considering the metal thing. We are more interested in the dielectric thing, because when you are having this kind of structure, anything interaction which is taking place on the top is important for us. So we are more considerate about the penetration depth. So it is only few hundred nanometers up to, it can go up to few microns also, but that is, you know, the engineering which is taking place for the designing. And not only that, it can enhance the electromagnetic field at the surface. So you can see, if you electric field is one, magnitude one, you can have mod ex square around say 20, 22 or 23, and in ez it can go up to around 100. So you can have 10^2 orders of magnitude enhancement in the electric field at the surface. What it means? It means that you have light of wavelength lambda. See, Ksp is greater than K of light. So if you want to have 2π/λsp is greater than 2π/λ. So it means that lambda is greater than λsp. Lambda is greater than λsp. That means you have light of wavelength lambda. You can confine this light in structures which are smaller than lambda, sub wavelength structures. You can still confine this light, you can convert this light to surface plasmons, and then that gets confined. And once it gets confined, you have enhanced electromagnetic field. Now think, Raman used white light, then we invented lasers. Lasers are intense, electric field is enhanced, you get enhanced signal. You using the same laser to study the Raman spectra. Now you place this molecule on the top of this metal. The molecule placed near the metal will feel about 100 times enhanced electromagnetic field. You can enhance the Raman signal. Not only that, this field, because it is enhanced electromagnetic field, any interaction taking place will see enhanced electromagnetic field. So that is the importance. That is the importance. So if you want to study certain biological processes on the surface, you can enhance the electromagnetic field. So you might have heard about the TIR, total internal reflection fluorescence microscopy, TIRF, where you have the total internal reflection, you have evanescent field, and this evanescent field will study the fluorescence properties in this vicinity. Now I am saying that now you have plasmons, you can enhance the electromagnetic field 10 to power 2 times. That is the first advantage. Second advantage is that you can do the engineering to change the penetration depth. What is the benefit? Suppose you want to study protein, viruses, bacteria, and they are having different, you know, dimensions. So if you have, say, penetration depth of 100 nanometer, it will only be able to study the proteins. But if you want to study the bacteria, you have to increase the penetration depth. That is penetration depth engineering. You can engineer the penetration depth by having different configurations, and that is can be done in long range SPR. We are not going to discuss that, but the purpose of this is tell you that you can enhance the electromagnetic field by 10 to power 2 times. Now let us see what is happening with localized plasmons. Localized plasmons are plasmons in metallic nanoparticles, which size is much, much smaller. Yes? Any questions? The size is much, much smaller than the wavelength of light. So if you are having light of, say, a green laser, suppose 532 nanometer, and you can see here the sizes are like 50 nanometer or so. And by changing the shape and size, you can have different colors. Okay. So what it means, we will discuss it more, but the history is very, it has very bright history, because Romans could make nanoparticles in 4th century AD. So the ancient times, people used, silver and gold and these to stain glasses in cathedrals, various cathedrals. You can see here this. The ancient glass makers, they didn't know that these are nanoparticles. But when they are making the manufacturing the glass, they will put the precursors in certain amount, and these will form nanoparticles, and then will form certain colors. So that is the beauty here. So they used to stain glasses by using nanoparticles. That's why they are still bright. They are not using dyes here. If you don't use dye, because dye will bleach after certain time, there will be photo bleaching. But here, nanoparticles, metallic nanoparticles, I mean, if you are using silver, it can get oxidized. But for gold, it can last almost forever. Okay, that is the beauty. So plasmon resonances of nanoparticles, what happens is that these are also the quanta of charge density oscillations in metallic nanoparticles now. So the electric field is like this, electron cloud gets displaced, and if you have frequency of omega, this will start to oscillate like this in this direction. So oscillating dipole in this direction will emit radiation in like this, maximum radiation like this. Okay. And when they are excited, when the frequency of incident light becomes equal to the oscillation frequency of the conduction electrons. The resonance frequency as well as the absorbance is highly dependent on the size, shape, and environment. Environment is important. That will tell you, the environment will tell you how you are going to study the interactions. Okay, so these are the things. There are certain advantages figure because they are confined to the light particle. Light gets extremely enhanced. Electromagnetic field gets extremely enhanced. All the light gets squeezed like nano lenses. And they don't need polarized light. They don't need any frequency matching condition, phase matching technique. You have simply a colloidal solution. You shine light, you excite plasmons. That's very simple. Here is a quasi-static approximation, like the plasmons, as I told that the size of this nanoparticles is much smaller than the wavelength of light. So you can have the quasi-static, like this magnetic nano, this metallic nanoparticle is feeling a static electric field. So you can solve this using our boundary conditions, and we arrive to this condition of polarizability, where you can see that the polarizability will shoot up when this is almost zero, and this happens only one of this thing is negative again, and this becomes negative when you have metal. So you can see, for example, the field enhancement in a 35 nanometer nanoparticle. So light, if it is excited in this direction, the maximum field is in this direction, and this is again very high. You can choose various kind of nanoparticles, and at the various ages you can calculate the resonances, and you can observe the LSPR by using dark field spectroscopy, dark field microscopy. So you is excited light by this, and the scattered light is captured only here, so all the direct light passes through this. So different colors and shapes will have different shapes and sizes will have different colors. You can make nano cells like this, and different nano cells will also have different colors. These are various kind of plasmonic structures people have used. You can use arrays of nano slits, nano hole array, nano rings, triangles, all over these things. This is field over nanospheres. Now let us discuss the mechanism, how it is going to enhance and how much enhancement we are getting. So you see, to understand this, I have taken very simple structure, that is metallic nanosphere. And let us say that a very small distance d from this sphere, you have a molecule. Okay. And now this molecule plus metallic sphere system, I am shining laser. So electric field which is felt by the molecule is electric field of the laser plus the plasmonic field due to the metallic sphere. E0 is the incident field, okay, and the plasmonic field is given by this relation. You can see that when this term goes equal to zero, you will have enhanced plasmonic field. So if you are at the resonance condition, resonance condition is epsilon m is equal to minus 2 epsilon 0. This is the resonance condition. When this term becomes almost zero, you have enhanced plasmonic field. So you want to achieve this condition zero at certain value of lambda, and then you enhance the electromagnetic field. So if you want to calculate the enhancement factor, you have the field at the nanoparticle molecule divided by the field, incident field. So this is roughly, you can take it like E plasmonic divided by E zero, and you have this thing. Okay. Now if you want to see the intensities, electromagnetic enhancement factor for Stokes signal, this is multiplication of two factors. Let us try to understand. So in the power, when I am taking the power, now not the field, power is like E square term. So you have E to power 4 term. Let us try to understand what is happening. You have the molecule and the nanoparticle system. You shine light of laser L, wavelength L, nu L is the laser wavelength, nu frequency, let us say frequency of laser is nu L. You are shining light. This is enhancing what? This is leading to Raman signal as well as the plasmonic enhancement due to the nanoparticle. Nanoparticle is enhancing the, so major part is the plasmonic enhancement at nu L frequency. This enhanced electromagnetic field is seen by the molecule, and then molecule will emit enhanced Stokes signal. This Stokes signal, since it is very close to the laser frequency, what will happen? That this again will get enhanced by the plasmonic nanoparticle. Two fold enhancement, two mechanisms. One is that laser itself is plasmonic scattered. This scattered light is seen by the Raman the molecule, which is scattering the Raman light. Raman scattered light which got scattered from the molecule will again get scattered from the nanoparticle. So that's why you have E to power 4 enhancement here. At the same time, you have this D to power 12. That means that if you are moving away from the nanoparticle, say only few nanometers, you don't have any Raman signal. This is a very highly localized phenomenon. So it has to happen at the surface. So you see that in general, if I know the Raman-Stokes power, if you have n number of molecules and the cross-section of Raman process is sigma r, and IL is the laser intensity, you have the power of Raman-Stokes signal is PRS. But when you have SARS, you have these two additional terms. This term is coming additional. This is the electromagnetic enhancement. This is sigma r when it was the molecule was free. Now the molecule is on the surface. So this is adsorbed molecule. So it will change the cross section of the Raman process. And this cross section change will also lead to enhancement in the Raman signal. That is called the chemical mechanism. This 10 to power 5 to 10 to power 9 times enhancement in the intensity is due to the electromagnetic mechanism. So it is mostly the film which is taking care of the enhancement. It is not the not much contribution from the adsorption at the surface. Okay. If you want to determine the enhancement factor, we say 10 to power 10 enhancement, 10 to power 5 enhancement, what it means. So to understand this, let us say that I am having n number of molecules, n number of molecules, and I measure the Raman intensity from the bulk. So suppose I am getting intensity I from n number of molecules. So if I want to know from how much intensity I got from one molecule, that will be I bulk divided by n bulk. And now I am putting n number of molecules again on the surface of metal film, and I am measuring the Raman SARS intensity. So this is the number of, so this is the Raman intensity or SARS intensity per molecule. So if I am dividing the SARS intensity per molecule to the Raman intensity per molecule in bulk, that will tell me the enhancement factor. So when I am saying 10 to power 10 enhancement factor, that means 10 to power 10 enhancement per molecule. People have used various kind of configurations, and you can see that they are getting 10 to power 6, 10 to power 6, 10 to power 5, 6 or something. And here we got around 10 to power 8 in AGNSTF, silver nanosculpture thin films enhancement. And how we are going to prepare this? These are very cheap films because you are not using any sophisticated techniques. You see, these are well-defined structures and very sophisticated, you know, to make this. You use electron beam lithography, but here you don't need any lithography. We use glancing angle deposition. You have the substrate at a glancing angle, light is coming and the Ag particle flux is like coming like this. You can have a rotation, and by rotation you can control the rotations, you can control the speed, you can control the temperature of the substrate, you can insert some gases, and based on that you can rotate this. You can have a motor here also which changes its position, and you can develop various kind of films. So we use this for detection of E. coli. This is the setup. You see, in a normal Raman setup, what happens that you have a laser and you have a Raman spectrometer. This is a fiber optic setup. So what we do is that you have fiber optical fiber cable. It collimates the light, and then you have laser line filter which will filter the light, and then this filtered light will go. The pure Raman, this 785 light will excite Raman signals here, and the same Raman signal is captured by this lens, which passes through this dichroic filter to from a long pass filter, because we are now studying only the Stokes signal, so it goes to the spectrometer. So you can see that there are certain molecules. These are not molecules. These are actually viruses which capture this bacterium, E. coli bacterium. So we are measuring the Raman spectra of various bacterial concentrations, and you can see that when we change the concentration from 150 cells to say 3 into 10 to power 5 cells, there is a decrease in the Raman intensity. Okay, and this decrease can be quantified like this if you want to see here. So you are first changing the concentration from here to here. This is a logarithmic scale because now the concentration is changing 10 to power 2 to 10 to power 5, and you can see that for this is for various kind of bacteria. If you have two E. coli strains, you see this kind of curves. For other than that, there is no change. So this we use for detection of bacteria, but there is something very important. I told you that the Raman signal can be enhanced only in the vicinity of the surface. Vicinity means around 2 to 3 nanometers. More than that, it will get lost. You will not have any enhanced Raman signal. I am detecting now bacteria about 1 micron. How are we able to detect 1 micron? See, if you want to study interaction at the surface using Raman, you have to have small molecules. But now here I am using big molecules and still getting this. Why I am getting this? Because now I am not getting the Raman signal enhancement from the bacteria. I am getting Raman signal enhancement from some nearby molecule which is changing when the bacteria are coming on the surface. See, there is a catch. There is a direct mode of Raman interaction and indirect mode of sensing. Direct mode of detection is you are directly detecting the Raman enhancement from the molecule or the changes in the molecule. I am not doing that. I am detecting the interaction, other kind of interactions, using this nearby molecule. So you can also use the Raman interactions of the Raman signals from the nearby molecule to study the interactions which are taking place because of the big molecules. So that is the advantage. Now I will quickly move to, I think I have good amount of time, so 20 minutes or so. So I will finish this. Now you see, yeah, I forgot to tell you one more thing, that when we are using these nanostructures, all these nanostructures, localized plasmons can enhance the electromagnetic field about 10 to power 3 times. LSP, extended surface plasmons, 10 to power 2 times. People now thought if we couple light from localized to extended, then can we have 10 to power 5 times? You see, if I have ESP-LSP coupling, if you couple this, see, you use laser to excite 10 to power 2 times or 10 to power 3 times. Now I am using laser to excite 10 to power 2 times, and this coupling to LSP further 10 to power 3 times. So people were very much interested, have been trying for long to do this configuration. Okay. Most of the times people studied this configuration. You have nanoparticles and then metal film, and you shine from the top. So light gets coupled to localized plasmons, and that couples to propagating plasmons. LSP to ESP coupling. In this one, light is coming from the back, so it is exciting propagating plasmons, extended plasmons, which are coupling to localized plasmons, and this is LSP, ESP to LSP coupling. So these are two kinds of couplings. I am telling you that people have been trying this actually most of the time, because this is very easy to make. You deposit a film on some substrate and you put nanoparticles and you shine light from the top and you want to study this system. This is very easy to do. So this was the most studied system. And why people are doing this? Because this SURS is a direct measure of near field enhancement. So if you measure the SURS spectra, you can immediately say how much enhancement is taking place. So for example, in here, one of the groups was using, actually group from Lee, they're using triangular nanoparticles, and on below this there was a glass substrate and a silver film, and then rhodamine 6G. So shining light from this and then collecting the Raman signal. So you can see that when there are isolated AG triangles plus this molecule plus silver film, you have large enhancement. If you have only AG film, you have this much enhancement. So that is the advantage. If you are using this, you can enhance the Raman signal. You can see that these signals are enhanced. ESP-LSP coupling enhancement is, so that means that there is large electromagnetic field. That is one-to-one relation. So that's what is the importance. About 2000 times here. You can see how much is the difference. So we studied this kind of system and we measured the effect of metal film and AU nanoparticle distance. How much is the distance dependence here? How much should be the distance? You can see that if we move away, say let us say 3 nanometer or so, then we don't have much much coupling between them, because you know the emergent field which is here because of the metal and emergent field here, the coupling here, it has to be strong. So if the emergent field of metal is like this and this is like this, the overlap between these two fields has to be large. So that's why it is very important for one to have them as close as possible. Second thing is the diameter of the nanoparticle. See, we are using 785 nanometer film, 785 nanometer laser. Now we are using 785 nanometer laser, so it is important for us to know what will be the diameter of this nanoparticle so that we get maximum enhancement. And we can see both, this is theory, this is experiments, that for 80 nanometer, this black one, we are getting maximum enhancement. If time permits, I will tell you why. Okay, and the most important part is this, that you have either ESP to LSP coupling or LSP to ESP coupling. So we studied both to understand which one is performing better, and we find that you can see that the maximum enhancement of the electromagnetic field, maximum enhancement is around 800. 800 means it is like 10 to power, you can go up to 10 to power 3, let us say 8 into 10 to power 2 is like of the order of 10 to power 3 or so. Here the average enhancement is around 75, only up to order of 10 to power 2. When you have ESP to LSP coupling, the average coupling is like 2 into 10 to power 2, 200 times. So it is 75, it is 200, so it's still better. And the maximum enhancement is around 10 to power 5 times. See, localized to propagating plasmons or extended plasmons, the coupling is weak. Why it is weak? Because there is a wave vector matching condition. You have lots of diffracted modes. When you have extended to localized plasmons, you have only one plasmon mode which is coupling now to the metals. So that is more advantageous process. That's why you have larger electromagnetic enhancement. And also you can see that it's not happening at all the positions. You have these nanoparticles and then there should be a gap. This gap is important. If you are having this gap around this, let us say around 1500 nanometer, then only you will have large enhancement. If you are placing them very close, aap ye soche, no, if you start thinking, okay, I have this surface and I put lots of nanoparticles, I will get more enhancement. No. You are not getting more enhancement. If you are putting lots of particles, the enhancement is not so high. If you are putting lots of particles, the enhancement is not so high. Maybe in this case, but not in this case. Maybe in this case, you can see that here it is less than 100 nanometers, but here it is like 1500 nanometers in this case. So it is not advisable to put lots and lots of nanoparticles to get more enhanced signal. No, you will not get. There is an optimum condition you have to achieve. And this we have proved here experimentally also. And you can see that when the gap was 1 micron or so or more, you had larger enhancement. So this is a metal film and on top of it, you have nanoparticles here. And you can see that when they are largely gapped, you have more enhancement signal. There is a more advantage of having ESP-LSP coupling. You can have off resonance and on resonances. If you want to turn off it like a switch, you can simply turn off the, you can move away from the resonance. If you move away from the resonance, you don't have any excited ESP. You have no excitation of ESP, so there is no coupling. So this is the advantage. And then we can use this for detection of glycerol. So we have used it for the detection of glycerol. And mind it that the enhancement factor which we achieved in the hotspot was about 10 to power 10 times. It's like almost burn everything. So let us try to conclude the talk. So we studied extended surface plasma on, and we also saw what is the potential of studying the dynamics at the surface, because it has evanescent tail of the electron, and this tail will study the interactions happening at the surface. That you can use it for the studying the interactions at the surface. That is the very basic thing. Then we studied localized surface plasmons, and we saw what is the mechanism of enhancement of Raman signal on plasmonic surfaces. What is the very basic of enhancement of plasmonic Raman signal at the plasmonic surface? See, if you want to calculate the intensities of Raman, you have to do a quantum mechanical approach. You have to use time dependent perturbation theory and to see the induced dipole movement, and then you have to calculate the expectation values from there so that you know what are the and the transition probabilities from Stokes and anti-Stokes. That will tell you the intensities of the Raman bands. I'm not talking about the intensities, I'm talking about the mechanism, electromagnetic mechanism, what is responsible for the enhancement of the Raman signal. Then I told you about the surface-based sensing of large analyte molecules using Raman. SURS is a very, very highly localized phenomenon, but it can still be used to study interactions of the molecules which are large inside. It means that suppose I have this surface. On the surface, I place a molecule, and on top of it there are other molecules which are interacting here, fighting, let us say, with each other. But this fighting will lead to change in the Raman signal of this. So if we can correlate this fighting or this interaction to the changes in the Raman signal of this molecule, we can still use the Raman SURS for studying the dynamics or interactions at the surfaces, even for the bigger molecules. And then in the last, we studied the ESP-LSP coupling based enhancement of electromagnetic field, and discussed how to use it for sensing or detection. So you are basically creating a nano, you can say that you are creating, see, this is metal and then 2 nanometer gap, and on top, after 2 nanometer gap, you are putting this sphere or whatever nano structure. So this 2 nanometer gap, you are creating a nano cavity. In this nano cavity, you will have enhanced tremendous amount of electromagnetic field, and then it will give you tremendous amount of signal. It is not only the Raman signal. We have done this for fluorescence also, but you have to keep in mind that the positioning of the nanoparticles is important. The size of the nanoparticles is important, because when we are talking about Raman, there is one more important thing which I should have told you. See, in Raman spectroscopy doesn't depend on the wavelength, because when you are measuring the Raman power, here you are plotting the Raman shift. Raman, I need to write it like this one more. So when you are measuring the Raman power, you are measuring the Raman shift. In centimeter inverse. What it means? It means that whatever be the laser you are using, let us say that this is Stokes and this is anti-Stokes, and you are measuring this shift. This is the laser. You are measuring this shift. Doesn't depend on the wavelength of laser. Intensities can change, but the position is just fixed. This delta lambda, or you can say delta nu of the Stokes line, it doesn't depend on the laser. But when you are talking about surface enhanced Raman spectroscopy, we are now using a film, let us say this nano rod like structures, the wavelength of laser should be such that it is resonating. It's the plasmon resonance. Plasmon resonance is matching with the wavelength of laser. So you have to make this structure such that it is resonating with the laser, or you have to choose a different laser. So now when you are using SURFs, you have to be careful that you are using a wavelength which is resonating at the plasmon wavelength. Okay, so with this I think we discussed SURFs. I wish to acknowledge the funding from various funding agencies. IIT Roorkee, I wish to thank IIT Roorkee for faculty initiation grant, DST Inspire for Inspire faculty grant, DST SERB for startup research grant, and MHRD STARS for another funding, for core research funding. And I wish to thank you for your kind attention. I can be contacted on this phone and this email if you are interested to know more about my work, and if you are interested to sincerely collaborate, you are most welcome. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Sachin, for this great talk on the surface enhanced Raman scattering. And now the session is open for discussion. So if you have any question, please write in the chat box, or you can unmute to ask if you have any query to Professor Sachin. And
sorry,
Pandey, to put the question if you find anything in the YouTube live.
Yes, I will take care.
So I don't find any questions in the chat box. I believe that people will ask. So no questions in the chat box means either they understood everything or they didn't understand anything.
I'm sure people have enjoyed your energetic and illuminating talk. I mean, if not, then we can like wait for a few minutes, or I can ask you a very it's a query, it is not a question or anything, because the glasses you said in the chart having different colors. So what is those nanoparticles made up of? I mean, what is it? Are they any metal based, or what type of nanoparticles are they?
So these nanoparticles are primarily of noble metals. They are silver or gold.
Oh, silver or gold. Okay.
Yes.
And having different, because this is interesting to know that, you know, you talked about degradable dyes. You know, dyes, they degrade, so you lose the color. But if you go to the I was in Europe, so I have seen lot of very old churches, and especially in Italy I have seen, and they are very old churches, but the color is still beautiful. You know, those glasses are having those colors, and that was very good to know. And another interesting thing is that you said that if you have a pearl, and this kind of spectroscopy can easily utilize to check the purity, or like there could be some fraud also. So basically, you know, we teach biomineralization. So, and where this pearl, they are formed as a kind of, you know, in the Western it is formed because of some kind of deposition of this calcium carbonate. So yeah, that was very interesting to know that how you can have that kind of
I wrote a proposal on detection of COVID-19 using research, but DVT said that it is in very early stage, so they didn't fund this. But again, we are trying to do something with it.
Okay.
So this technique can be used for detection and studying interaction on surfaces, whatever kind of interactions you want to study on surfaces and whatever molecules, and you prepare something and you want to know if it is pure or not, if there are some impurities. This is very useful technique.
Okay, that's great. Is there any biomolecular kind of applications related?
Yes.
Can you highlight a little bit of some biomolecular surface spectroscopy based on this Raman?
See, one thing I showed you, that biosensor which we are working on, like detection of E. coli, detection of endocrine disruptors. We detected hepatitis A virus and other bacteria using these techniques. So this is quite possible. And second thing is, mostly chemists actually used to study the reaction dynamics and kinetics using this. So if some binding is taking, so I'm not talking about SIRS, let us say SPR, if some binding is taking place, then the binding will lead to change in the signal. And then if you put some other chemical, then say there is now again some other reaction, so it will show the reaction dynamics also there. So you can know the coefficients, or what, I forgot the name, the coefficient for the reaction. I forgot the name for what you use for this.
Okay, no problem.
Okay.
That's great to know that. You see, chemists and physicists, they are coming, and we are really emphasizing the interdisciplinary research kind of.
Yeah.
Isn't it?
It's multidisciplinary. Yes, this field is multidisciplinary. I am working mostly with environmental biologists and medical people and of course chemistry people, and because everyone has limitations. My limitation is, my goal is to place these nanoparticles in such a way that you have very high enhanced electromagnetic field. And once you have enhanced electromagnetic field, you can do whatever kind of sensing and interaction you want to study. So that is the advantage. Yeah.
We still have few minutes to and so if you are having any kind of query, all the participants, I'm telling you, are most welcome to ask Professor Sachin, and he will be happy to answer your query. Otherwise, I will just let us wait for a few minutes. So I don't think otherwise, Professor Ravinder, is there any question in the YouTube live?
Yes, there is one question from Dr. Susan Sahu, and he has asked the question that how to tackle reproducibility issues with substrate and do quantitative SERS.
Yeah, that's a very good question. See, this has been a problem for long, that people use SERS and they are not getting the same kind of enhanced, let us say in quantitative signal. But when you are using the kind of films which we use, let us say the nanorod like structures, we are using about 10 to power 1 lakhs of structures in one go. About 10 to power 5 nanorods in this focused spot. So the response which you are getting is kind of averaged. Okay? That is one advantage. The second thing which one can do is something called self-referencing, which we are working on very actively now, is that when you excited the, let us say the plasmon, plasmonic structure, you are also heating it because it is capturing lots of light, so there is heat. This heat, let us say you are measuring the signal now, you are measuring the signal after 30 minutes, it's possible because of heat, the reference changed. Now, if you somehow can measure the reference again, so that was the catch in this E. coli sensing. We performed this experiment for almost 2 years, and every time we are getting different signals. So the problem was how to deal with these kind of problems. So what you can do is that you can take the reference just before you perform the experiment, that particular experiment, and you subtract this reference only after the experiment. So you have to keep on updating the reference. This way you can have, you know, more confirmed, more confident response in quantitative analysis. That is the only way. Okay. And the second thing, which is taking you know, lots of boost these days, is machine learning. So you write an algorithm which trains your model and takes care of all these fluctuations, then it will be very easy to do the quantitative analysis. That is the second thing you can do. The, but for now, what we are doing is that we are doing the updating the reference every time, and we are measuring the change in the from that reference. So if reference change from here to here, we are measuring the signal from this reference now, not from that reference. So this is how you are going to control this drift in the performance. All right.
Okay. So any other?
So how much time do we have? I thought that we will have 10 minute discussion or something.
Yes, no, we are just in time. It is just 12:30. I think if any question comes, we'll take it. Otherwise, we'll conclude the session. Professor Pandey, is there any other question?
Oh, no.
Okay, thank you. So I think I would like to thank Professor Nivedita Pal and Professor Sachin, our two speakers of the morning session, and I'd like to thank you so much for your participation and your talk. I'm sure all of the participants, they have enjoyed, and I'd like to request Professor Ravinder Pandey to talk about the next session, and thank you all for participating this like TQEP program. Okay, so Professor Pandey.
Yeah, thank you, Professor Ghosh. Thank you all the participants and the speaker, Professor Nivedita Pal and Professor Sachin Kumar Srivastava. I have one quick announcement that we will meet at 4 o'clock for our next talk, which will be given by Professor Manvendra Chandra, and followed by that talk in the same link, we will have the validatory function. So I request you to kindly join. I have already sent the invitation for it, and we will meet at 4 o'clock. Thank you all.
Okay.